Dave Everson, Planning Commissioner, will lead us in the pledge.
Please rise.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Can we have the roll call, please?
Yes. Commissioner Everson?
Here.
Vice Chair Cummings?
Here.
Commissioner Goldberg?
Here.
Commissioner Galbraith? Absent. And Chairperson Massa-Levitt?
Here. Can we have a motion to excuse Commissioner Galbraith?
So moved.
Second. Okay, please vote. 4-0. By motion of the Planning Commission, this is the time to notify the public of any changes to the agenda, rearrange the order of the agenda, and provide an opportunity for any member of the Planning Commission or staff to request an item be removed from the consent calendar for separate action. Do we have anyone that appear that wants to change anything? No. Okay. I never remember. Do we have to vote on that?
Yes.
Can we have a motion to approve the agenda?
So moved.
Second it?
Second.
Okay. Please vote. 4-0. Oral communications. At this time, members of the public may address the Planning Commission regarding any items within the subject matter jurisdiction of the Commission. Pursuant to the Brown Act, the Commission cannot discuss or take action on any items not on the agenda unless authorized by law. Those members of the public wishing to speak are asked to come forward to the microphone, state their name for the record, and all speakers will be limited to a period of 5 minutes. This is the part on the agenda where you may speak on items that are not on the agenda. So if you have something you want to talk about other than the three items, then please come forward now.
Good evening. Good evening, Mike Beebe, Old Town South Beach. Good evening, commissioners, staff. I would like to make general comments on the CUPs. Is that appropriate during oral communications? I'm not going to comment specifically on what's in front of us tonight.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. I just wanted to kind of review last week where the commission approved a CUP for units on Silway, where there was a three-bedroom, two-bath, and the other unit was either a two- or three-bedroom, one-bath, and there was one parking place available for both of the units. This is for a short-term vacation rental. And the point was made by the owner and by the owner's attorney that probably what's going to happen most of the time is that these rentals are going to be rented by one family that flies in and they rent a minivan, and the whole family is inside the minivan and they just use that one parking place, and they have less of a parking impact on the neighborhood than if it was a regular year-round rental. And I disagree with that reasoning, that there's always going to be one family there with a minivan in this three-bedroom, two-bath place, and they're always going to be parking that one vehicle off-street. If the applicant for the CUP really believes this, then I think part of the CUP should be that the rental is restricted to one car per vacation rental, and that this be part of the process, that the vehicle be identified in some way so that parking is not impacted. I'm incredibly grateful to be living in South Beach in Old Town, and the parking is something that's, you know, relatively small, I suppose, in comparison to the benefits of living here. But I have observed over the past 40 years that parking is becoming more impacted, and I think we all can look at our neighborhoods, no matter where we live, and see that, you know, that there are more cars on the street because there's kids are staying at home longer, there's more people living in units and so on. So I think you all can identify with that, no matter what your community is. I would just like to see the commission for the applicants tonight and for the succeeding CUPs for the vacation rentals take into consideration the parking. And if there is only one parking spot and there's three bedrooms and you're going to allow two person per bedrooms, that part of the CUP specify that there is only one vehicle for that rental and somehow monitor that. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments.
And Commission and staff, Mark Lupesco, Old Town. I guess I'd like to echo what Mike just said and maybe ask a question if during your comments, Greg or Quinn, if you can answer this. If part of our code requirements here in town for a residential house requires two parking places on premise, how then do we justify a vacation rental under a CUP process with only one parking place? So it's just a question. Maybe I'm naive on the codes, but I'm finding a little problem justifying the one space for a vacation, even though it might be considered it's a housing unit, whether it be vacation long term or rental long term. Or full-time residential? How do we only still allow one parking? Thank you.
Thank you. We'll move on to the consent calendar now. The only item on the consent calendar is approval of the Planning Commission meeting minutes of September 5th, and I understand there is a correction.
Yes, Madam Chair. On page 9, the fourth bullet down, there are some comments there regarding my comments at the last meeting. And I think the city clerk left out the word not when I referred to the limiting the number of standard size canopies on roofs. I made the point that I was not in favor of limiting the number of standard size canopies. City clerk did listen to the tape and confirm that, and she has written up some suggested language that I'm fine with, and so that's before you. And so I would move to approve the minutes with the changes as presented to you in the memo from the city clerk.
Okay. Is there a motion? Oh, you just made the motion.
That's the motion.
Is there a second?
Second.
Please vote.
Thank you.
4-0. Good. There are no scheduled matters. We'll go right into public hearings. Conditional use permit 12-8 at 121 13th Street. Can we have the staff report, please?
Yes, Madam Chair, members of the Commission. This item is for conditional use permit 12-8 at 121 13th Street. For request for a conditional use permit to allow a short-term vacation rental property within the residential high-density zone. The property at 121 13th Street is a two-story duplex property. There is a two-bedroom unit upstairs in the rear of the property that's situated over a double tandem garage. And there is a front unit that is a three-bedroom unit that is actually an upstairs-downstairs unit situated towards the front of the property. As has been the case with the last several vacation rental units that we've been discussing here over the past few months, staff feels that the units are of adequate size to propose a maximum of two occupants per bedroom. Staff is also proposing that two additional occupants be allowed for the front larger unit. The property here has been operated as a vacation rental since at least 2010, according to city records. Staff has contacted Seal Beach Police Department, and SBPD reports only one call for service at this address, and that was in June of this year. The call it was unclear from the report that I got back from SBPD as to exactly what happened with the call, and maybe the applicant, when they come up, can shed a little more light on it. But from what I could gather, the call was pertaining to occupants that apparently left the unit in disarray and possibly caused some damage to it. There, as I mentioned previously, there is a double tandem garage on the property that is conforming, as well as additional off-street parking located in front of that garage, as shown on the plans that were submitted. Staff has received one email in opposition to the project, and that was passed out before you on the dais this evening. We received it after the staff report packets went out last week, so that was provided for you before the meeting. And with that, that concludes staff's report, and I'm available for any questions.
Thank you. Are there any questions of staff of this project?
I have a couple questions.
Go ahead.
First is, I will demonstrate my ignorance. What is double tandem parking?
A tandem configuration is generally where, rather than a traditional two-car garage where you have cars parked side by side, in a tandem configuration you have them parked one behind the other. And in a double tandem configuration, you essentially have a two-car with garage, but it parks four cars.
Two cars deep, then, also.
Two cars deep, exactly. Okay. And as shown on the plan that was submitted, in addition to the double tandem garage, there does appear to be adequate space behind the garage to park two additional cars on the pad.
On the pad. Is that why staff is recommending occupancy of 8 people in the 3-bedroom?
That is one of the reasons. Staff feels that the unit is of adequate size to be able to accommodate that many persons, as well as the fact that there is more than conforming parking on the site. So staff feels that you could easily park, you know, 3 cars per unit on site.
Okay.
So parking should
so
not
even
be an issue.
Even with a total of 12 on property maximum, this should not have any impacts on the neighborhood and parking.
As conditioned, we feel it shouldn't, but that's part of the reason.
Assuming two people per car, which is a good assumption.
With as far as parking impacts, there we feel that there's adequate parking on site to address any potential impact.
Okay. You and I exchanged a couple emails today regarding the deadline issue.
Correct.
One of the facts is that the filing of this application was on July 11th, and the deadline per the ordinance was July 6th. Can you tell us the circumstances by which staff felt that that July 6th deadline should be waived in this case?
There were a few applicants that had contacted staff prior to the July 6th deadline. In this particular applicant's, if I remember correctly, they had contacted me several times beforehand and had stated that they had every intent to apply for the conditional use permit, but for whatever reason, and again, they might be able to shed a little more light on this, would not be able to make the July 6th deadline. And staff chose to, since I was out of the office in the week from July 1st to July 7th and unavailable to answer any questions that might have come up before that deadline, staff decided that since the applicant's intent was to apply for the CUP, that we would give a few extra days grace period for those that had contacted staff prior to the deadline to let us know that they may not be able to make the deadline.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions? I have a comment. The plan shows a double tandem 4-car garage, yet there's only 3 cars available to park in there, 3 parking spaces. I assume that's because there must be a storage shed. It's identified in the plan that obstructs the space for the 4th car. Is that how it might be, Jerry?
The plan does show that there, I'm assuming it's some sort of storage cabinet in a portion of the garage. I'm not sure if it's a removable cabinet. Again, the applicant might be able to shed a little more light on that. But when the property was originally built in the 1970s, it was built, the garage was intended to be a double tandem garage. So if it's something that where the storage is easily removable, like if you went to Home Depot and bought just or IKEA or something and bought a storage cabinet, that may be something that could be removed.
We'll find out. Okay, is the applicant here? Can we ask you to come up and tell us about your project and why you think you ought to be granted a conditional use permit?
Hello, my name is Janet Connie, and this is my husband, Christopher Geyer, and we're married, and we own the home. And we primarily use it as a vacation home for ourselves, for a second home, and as well as renting it out sometimes. If I could start and answer a couple of the questions that were posed while I have them on the top of my head.
Sure.
Okay. The first question regarding the deadline that you had asked about. Yes, I had contacted Jerry 3 or 4 times, getting instructions from him regarding where we would go to hire a company to do the radius map. And the labels and all of that was required as part of the conditional use permit. We're not a company, and we don't have any employees. It's just Chris and myself. So it took a lot of time, and we both work also, just to figure out what we were supposed to do and do it the correct way. We wanted to comply with all of the regulations. So Jerry was kind enough to give us a few extra days. And regarding the garage, the storage in the garage, it's a shelving unit. So it's not even a shed. And we keep things like paper towels and toilet paper and things like that on it. And it's definitely removable. And regarding also the parking, generally we rent to a family. So usually there's not 2 cars per bedroom. In the upper unit, it's usually 1 family of 4, sometimes just a couple, and they have 2 adults, 2 children. There's 1 car, usually. Sometimes in the front unit, in the lower unit, there may be 2 cars.
And we still have 5 cars to, we can park 2 right behind the garage, as you can see on the map, so yes, you can get 5 cars on our site without any impact outside.
Yes.
So the history, we bought this house, as I had said, as a second home for the two of us in October of 2010. And at that time, we got an idea from the previous owner, Ron Haynes, who had also rented it out as a vacation rental, to possibly do that when we weren't living there. And so we looked into it, applied for the business license, which was granted in 2010, complied with all the regulations, including the transient occupancy tax, have been paying that every quarter, and use it ourselves as well as rent it out mostly to families, sometimes to couples. Anything else that you can think of regarding the history? Oh, one more clarification. The police report, we brought the contract. Actually, it was in September of 2011. I know you said June, and we actually were the ones that called the police. We don't have any employees. We do everything ourselves, cleaning, renting it out, managing, sending the contracts. I went over there to pick up all the laundry, and I saw the house was in disarray. And I called Chris, and you're the one that actually called the police.
I contacted Seal Beach just to be on record and help us with the security deposit issue that we would have had with the renter. So it was a call initiated by us.
Okay. Really to protect ourselves.
Thank you for clarifying that.
Nothing was broken, nothing was stolen, but things were in disarray, and there was a concern that there might have been a fraudulent use of a credit card.
Wow. And the police wouldn't tell me what they found. They said they needed to keep it confidential, so I can't tell you anything else.
Okay, thank you. Are there any questions from the commission?
I have a couple questions. Item number 10 on the conditions of approval, the dual tandem four-car garage, that requirement would require that entire space to be used as a garage space, not as a storage space. Is that your intent?
Well, yes, that is our intent, but we've never had to even use that spot because we give the people in the upstairs unit 1 garage space and 1 driveway space. It's a full-length driveway. And whenever there are people in the front unit, we give also 2 spaces, a garage space and a driveway space. Sometimes they use both spaces in the garage. They park front and back, We've never had an issue with anybody parking even on the street. Many times, both units are not rented out at the same time, many times. And so if you wanted us to take down that storage shelf, it would be very easy to do it, or locate it next to the washer and dryer, which is more out of the way. And we can certainly comply with that.
Okay. Well, we do feel that the current configuration allows parking of the renters plus a guest if they even wanted it without any impact in the surrounding area or on the streets.
That would make sure that they're off the street if you move that storage area.
Yes, absolutely. Part of the reason people choose our place is we give them a garage. They don't want to park on the street because a lot of them are families and they have car seats or booster seats in their minivans or whatever they're renting, and they don't even want to leave it out on the street. Plus, they don't want to have to hunt for parking.
Can you blame them?
Absolutely not.
Any other questions?
Item number 15 on the conditions of approval deals with the on-site management of the property and who's to be contacted. You guys don't hire out a consultant agency. You run the property yourselves?
We run the property ourselves. I forwarded Jerry 3 sample contracts, and within the contract, it actually gives our names and our telephone number. They have access to us 24 hours a day. And we live in, our other home is in Westminster, so it's about a 7-minute drive. And we've never had any difficulty. We screen our renters really well before we rent to them because we don't want any problems either.
Any other questions?
That's all for me.
Okay. Dr. Goldberg?
Do you remember when you got a notice from the city notifying you that a cup would be required?
Well, the certified letter notice came to the Seal Beach property, and we weren't living there at the time. We had vacationers there. So it took probably 3 weeks before we actually even got the notice. I think one of our vacationers picked it up by mistake. But as soon as I got the notice, I went to the post office, picked up the packet, and then immediately called Jerry. And since I'm actually a doctor, so I don't know anything about anything like this. I immediately called Jerry and I said, what's a radius map? What's a notification packet? How do I even go about doing this? He gave me the name and the telephone number of a company in, I think they were in Laguna, that did this. I immediately called them the next day. But because we were coming up on the 4th of July holidays, I mean, I think I called her on about June 18th. She said it would take over 3 weeks to get this packet. So I couldn't even get the notification packet. And I called Jerry back and I told him that. So I was in constant contact with him, telling him the status of what we were doing and how we were going about it. I mean, in addition, I made those drawings myself. And I'm not a professional at all, but since it's just my husband and I doing this, we did it all ourselves. So we did the best we could and contacted Jerry to let him know what we were up against. And I told Jerry I could get him the packet on the Wednesday, and I did. I was there at 10 a.m. Wednesday morning when I told him I would be dropping off about a 3-inch tall packet.
Okay. Thank you very much. If we have any other questions, we'll ask you to come up. Did you have something you wanted to say?
Jerry had handed us the, the opposition to our CUP.
Yes.
Here, so is this the right venue to respond to that?
Yes, you may.
We've owned the property since 2010 before this process was in place, and at that time, our understanding it was there were no requirements or
right
regulations on vacation rental use. So
other than obtaining a business license, which we did.
Yeah, which right. We had. And the issues with respect to this I saw here that they think this is an abuse of the process or the zoning process.
Mm-hmm.
I would ask the city attorney if that's the case or not.
We'll ask him to respond to that in a little while.
Okay.
Thank you.
And we did have one more question regarding, a question for you, regarding this language.
If you look at provision 25 in your conditional use, or under the conditions of approval.
Mm-hmm. Indemnification.
Can you explain to us why?
Would you like to do that, Mr. Attorney?
Sure.
Okay.
This is a standard condition in all of our conditional use permits, variances, and subdivision applications. If the city, or the Planning Commission, or the City Council grants the CUP or the other permits, we require this condition. So in the case that the city gets sued for issuing the permit, you'll have to defend the city on that decision.
It is a typical decision, typical condition of approval. It's on all of the applications.
What, the one question we had, since we are not, or we don't feel that we are directly providing a service for you, for the city, we're wondering why that's in here. We understand that if a contractor or an architecture firm hires a consultant, that's a standard clause, but we're not in business with you, really, so to speak. We're not providing a service for you. So we're just a little bit confused on that aspect of it.
I can further elaborate. As part of the conditional use permit, it's an entitlement that you're receiving. The city's not receiving any entitlement to grant you the permission to continue this business at this residence. And so it's a standard provision that we require of all the applicants who successfully obtain a CUP, that in the case somebody sues the city for issuing that permit, we let the property owner, who has more of a vested interest in the decision, actually defend the case. It's also, once again, it is standard language, and it certain parts of this, since you're not doing any work, there is the indemnification that we have standard for all CUPs when. Now, let's say a restaurant is going to construct a restaurant. Something happens at that restaurant. Once again, the city has no stake in the matter, and so we want that business to defend us. So in this case, the only thing that you need to be worried about, since you're not going to be doing any work on this, is really if someone files a lawsuit challenging the decision of the city. And it could happen. It may not happen. So far, no one has sued on any of these applications, and we're not really expecting people to sue on something like this.
I guess I would ask the Planning Commission, is it possible to just add a word to this, which should be at the last line there, just to say at least reasonable attorney's fees? Not being an attorney myself.
Is there such a thing?
I don't know. Can we modify that?
Reasonable attorney or reasonable fees?
No, reasonable fees.
And it's something they can consider after they close the public hearing.
All right. Okay, we'll talk about it.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else that would like to testify on this item?
Mike Beebe, Old Town. As far as the shelving in the garage, I think that's fine with me. As long as you can get a car in the garage, I'm okay with shelving in there for storage. And as far as the applicant being late, I don't think I don't have any problem with that. But I would like to see, as part of the CUP, that the renters be required to park the cars off the street at all times in all this parking.
Thank you. Anyone else?
My name is Nancy Cradell, and I live in Old Town on Seal Way, and I'm very opposed to the vacation rentals, and I would like to know if these people have vacation rentals near them in Westminster. I don't think they would like to have people partying at all different times right next to them, and we would like family life. It isn't like, and you can see how close they are to the neighbors. it isn't the same as having a person that stays there year in and year out. People that come at short term are much more likely to be a lot noisier and have, they're on vacation, they're relaxed, they're doing what they want to do. And that isn't conducive to our family life. And I think that the city, in fairness, if they're going to do any of this, that they should check much more frequently on the garages, whether they're being used, or tandem did not work. That's why you don't do it anymore. Tandem is precludes a lot of storage in that first inward parking space. That's why it isn't allowed anymore. So please put something in that somebody will go by. I've heard we have a person that is there on the weekends, that a code enforcement person should be going and checking much more frequently. But I think it's wrong.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Good evening. Barbara Barton, Old Town. Well, I'd like to turn down every CUP that comes up here because I don't like vacation summer rentals. I'm existing next to one. In fact, August was the worst month of my life in Seal Beach, and I'll elaborate on that. We were broken into, robbed of money and jewelry. The police, I hope, are still working on that. We have put a burglar alarm system in. We have changed all the locks. Someone had got in and gotten my keys and my purse, taken cash, jewelry, and money. And I'm scared to death to have a vacation rental next to me. And I would like for all these people to have these properties just to pray to God they can rent to long-term renters instead of vacation rentals. I know they can make a lot of money, but the quality of life here is what we're thinking about. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? You may come up again and speak.
Just to address the few
Could
points.
Could you just give us your name again?
Janet Connie. To address the two or three points that were brought up, no, we don't have a vacation rental next to us in Westminster. However, we don't rent to partiers. The couple that occupied our house for the whole month of August were a couple in their 80s, a man and a woman in their 80s. And they weren't partying. There was no noise. There was no trouble. It'd probably be less of a nuisance than actually if you want to talk about, you brought up neighbors, the house to the right, it's a triplex and it's rented out to three different sets of people and many of them are young and they party and our vacationers have told us they keep them up. So just because you rent to someone permanently, so to speak, doesn't mean you're not going to have noise. And the other issue is that the people do use our garage. There's nothing in it except for that small storage shelf. And we've been doing this for almost 2 years and have never had a problem, except when Chris called the police.
Yeah, I just want to say, I don't know if you're any more at risk with someone who's a longer-term renter than the short-term renter that could be there. And the people that live next door to us, to the right in the picture, if you look at it, are a good example of that.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Any discussion among the commission?
I'd like to comment on some of the public comments.
Go ahead.
Questions. Mr. Beebe has raised the issue about us trying to exert some control over the number of cars, and I think you just made the point about where the cars park. And I wanted to just mention to Mr. Beebe and the other members of the public that I've raised that question several times about whether we can control the number of cars, and we've been told by the city attorney that that's not feasible or we can't do it. And I know Quinn, you're pitch hitting here. I don't know if
yes.
You can speak to that.
Well, I've talked to Stephen about that issue, on this very issue, and it's more of an enforcement problem because, you know, we can't just have people out there, staff people, you know, watching the cars and seeing where they park. And you know, every one of these properties is going to end up, even on a short-term basis, when I say short-term basis, there may be times when they're dropping people off, they're going to be on the street. And so it's almost impossible. Well, it is impossible to enforce. I don't know how you would be able to do it. I mean, you could put it as a condition. It just wouldn't be enforceable. I mean, if we catch them somehow, you know, it might be something. But still, once again, it would be very tough to enforce.
We would have to really act on complaints, right, in order for there to be noncompliance with the parking spaces. If we received a number of complaints that people aren't using the garage,
yes,
then we could force something without having to put another condition.
Yeah, definitely, because, I mean, that's clearly not the intent of the discretionary permit. And so we get a complaint that they're using their entire garage or half of it for storage. I mean, that's a violation.
I don't recall seeing in here, does it say that there's a four-car tandem garage?
Condition 10.
10, okay.
And one, okay. If I might add to that, one of, in the cases where we've had vacation rentals that do have garages, and I think practically all of them, except for maybe one so far, has not. We have always placed a condition on these that if garages are available on the property, that they remain free and clear for the use of the short-term occupants.
Well, you know, without getting draconian in terms of our conditions of approval or our inspection process, do you agree that working on a complaint basis would be the way to enforce something like this? If the neighbors are complaining that there are people there with a half a dozen cars and they're not using the garage and they're parking all over the street, do you think that would satisfy you in terms of a complaint that we could act on as Planning Commission?
Yes and no. I mean, we are open to hearing complaints. Complaints can be brought to staff. Mm-hmm. And, you know, if we've made a mistake, like, for example, Mr. Buby mentioned the one we approved on Seal Way last week that I voted against because of parking. You know, if I turn out to be right and that the parking is grossly inadequate and the neighbors complain, they can complain to staff. My understanding is that we could bring that back. I mean, we could review the cup if there are complaints on it. That's my understanding. Is that correct?
Absolutely.
Yes.
Okay. So, like, for example, on Seal Way, if we erred in granting that one and the parking is onerous to the neighbors, then maybe we'd have to reconsider that. So, yeah. So, yes, we could. To answer your question, yes, we could reconsider it if people complain about it. And that's why I've insisted upon having a condition here that the immediate neighbors are notified of the conditions that it's a vacation rental, and we have that in all of these. So the people surrounding the property know what the rules are. And again, if the garage is not kept open, those neighbors can also complain with the city, and that would be a reason to bring the cup back as well, if the garage is not kept open.
Well, I won't get into the specifics of that, but did we agree at one point to notify neighbors of the conditional use permit and copy them? I seem to have remembered that, but I wasn't sure.
We had a debate regarding how many neighbors, and
that's right.
The resolution was that it would be
adjacent,
which is two, and that's been in all of them.
Okay. That on this particular resolution, it's condition number 15.
Okay, thank you.
The other issue was raised by Nancy Cridell and it relates to this conversation, and that's the whole concept of inspections. And I'm wondering if staff, can you tell us, is the city planning on doing any inspections of any of these?
At the moment, I don't believe that we have an inspection mechanism in process. I know that when the ordinance was passed by the council in May, it did include provisions for such, and I think, I don't know if Greg or the city attorney might be able to elaborate a little more on this. I didn't happen to be at that meeting in May of the council, but my understanding of it was that the requirement for inspections was placed on vacation rental properties, and that when we contacted OC Fire Authority, they stated that they at the moment do not have any inspection mechanism in place for such short-term vacation rentals. However, I believe that the intent of that was to, in the future, if a mechanism does become enacted, that these short-term vacation rentals would need to comply with that inspection process.
Yeah, because the only provision that I see in the ordinance for inspections, annual inspections, is in relationship to the fire safety. And as you mentioned, OCFA is not going to be doing that. Apparently, they have the right to do it, but they're not going to be doing it. And so there really isn't any provision for sort of a routine inspection here. Obviously, if there's a problem and there's a police complaint, there is a provision for police to have access to the property or a city inspector to have access if there's a complaint response. But that may be something that, you know, for the final ordinance, which we're going to be considering sometime in the future here, is this whole issue about inspections, and we can hear more from the public regarding the inspections, but that is a little bit of a weak spot right now. And some of the applicants have complained that we're setting up the neighbors to be inspectors, and that is what we're doing. And I'm okay with that. They're the ones that are most impacted, and that, again, that's why I insisted that at least the two adjacent neighbors be notified. But they're really going to have to bird dog this. If the parking's out of control, tell Jerry. If they're not keeping their garage open, tell Jerry. If they're having parties, whatever. And Jerry. It could come back to us if the behavior is not appropriate. That's it for my comments. Thank you.
Thank you. David?
Chair, if I can just interrupt. Did you close the public hearing, or are you still?
No, I left it open.
Okay.
We're not.
Intentionally?
In case somebody, the owner wants to comment.
I'm not entirely convinced we've made the neighbors, you know, be the inspector. I hope that what we're doing is in some way protecting the neighbors and putting a safeguard in place for them to have, you know, a reasonable tenant next to their house. So I hope that that's what we're doing more than forcing an inspection process on the neighbors. As far as the parking inspection goes, you know, it hasn't been a part of what we've required on vacation rentals up to this point. This particular property is probably one of the best parked properties we've seen. As far as condition number 10 goes, which was the dual tandem garage, I would be willing to allow the applicant to keep their storage in place and have essentially a three car garage if they were willing to eliminate the additional two renters in the base unit. That's a condition we have allowed before we've, you know, because in my opinion, that if we reduced one parking spot, the property would no longer be in full parking compliance, but it would be still very well parked. So I would like to allow the applicant to comment on that item. Let's see. I think the property management aspect of this is adequate. I feel like we haven't had any record of complaints on the property. The owners are locals, and they seem to be available and have an on-site presence, which I think are all beneficial to this property. So, and then item number 25, I don't really know what adding the term reasonable in front of attorney's fees, how that impacts the city. I would prefer that we keep the statement as it's written, unless the, say, the council or the city attorney wants to give us some direction to do otherwise, but I'll leave that to other commissioners. That concludes my comments.
Thank you. Ms. Cummings?
Nope.
No comments? Well, I have to say that this is the best parked plan. But I think in terms of what the storage is constructed of right now, I think it's easy enough to move. We have a four-car tandem garage. Let's make it a four-car tandem garage. And if it's, you could put that storage up front near the washer and dryer without it being too intrusive, then let's have you do that. And we would need a condition of approval, don't you think, to, or do we? Since the since the condition says there has to be a four-car garage.
Right. Item 10.
We wouldn't have to put in a condition of approval to move the storage. They'll just be on notice to do that.
Yeah, it's already covered under 10. It's got to remain free and clear for the four cars.
Okay. What is the pleasure of the commission?
Madam Chair, I have a couple more follow-up questions.
Go ahead.
I'm sorry. What is the city attorney's opinion regarding the insertion of the word reasonable fees? What is your opinion on that?
It's entirely up to you, and the reason we've the standard language does not include reasonable is that the risk you run if you put reasonable is that later on you'll spend time litigating the issue of whether it's reasonable or not.
Right.
And so we're trying to protect the city because once again, you know, this is an entitlement for them. It's not an entitlement for the city. And so we want them to, it's shifting the risk to the person who's getting the benefit of the conditional use.
How many times have we been sued on something like this? Ever?
Yes, but, well, something like this? Never.
Never.
Never on any type of single family use. In fact, typically the only lawsuits where we've had to use that if the city council's approved a major project like the Hellman Ranch project, for instance, and the Bixby project. Those are the only two times we've been sued on an entitlement.
And this isn't big enough for anybody to...
Right. Those were projects, as you know, acres, 200 acres in one, and not sure what Bixby is, but it was pretty...
pretty big.
Yeah.
The last question I had for city attorney is... What is our authority to waive the July 6th deadline that's in Section 8A?
You've got the discretion to do that. Essentially, that deadline was to provoke people to resolve these issues as quickly as possible. And under these circumstances, you know, with Jerry out and their good faith effort, would recommend that... that you disregarded. You don't even need a formal waiver of that at all. Just it was just a factor to consider. Okay.
All right. Thank you.
Did you want to say anything as the owner? Are you satisfied? Okay. All right. We'll close the public hearing. And what is the pleasure of the commission?
I move that we grant conditional use permit for this, let's see, which number is it? It's conditional use permit 12-8 for the use of this property as short-term rental.
I'll second.
Please vote. 4-0.
The commission's decision is subject to appeal, and anyone who wants to appeal the decision has 10 days from tomorrow to file an appeal to the City Council.
Thank you. Okay, our next item is conditional use permit 12-9 at 1616 and a half Ocean Avenue.
Madam Chair, members of the Commission, this item is conditional use permit 12-9 at 1616 and a half Ocean Avenue. This particular request for a conditional use permit to allow a short-term vacation rental property within the residential high-density zone. This particular property is a two-story duplex property. It has a, it's a duplex property. It's a detached duplex. There is a front house that is owner-occupied, and then there is a rear detached unit above the garages that is proposed to be used as a vacation rental. Staff is proposing a maximum, it's a one-bedroom unit, and staff is proposing a maximum of two occupants for the unit. However, in conversations subsequent to the distribution of the staff reports that I've had with the property owner, he would possibly like to amend the number of occupants, as he's explained to me that some of his past occupants have been two adults with either a small child or a couple small children. It was unclear on the plan that was submitted as to whether or not there was adequate room within the property to allow that. Typically, what staff has been doing is on properties that do have large interior areas, especially larger living rooms, where you may be able to fit either a pull-out sofa or a some type of bed that would fit in there, and the parking is adequate. There have been at least one or two occasions where we have recommended additional occupants beyond the two-person per bedroom. But I'll let the applicant explain a little further as to what his reasoning is for wanting to request additional applicants. The property has been operated as a vacation rental since at least 2009. Seal Beach Police Department reports only one call for service, and that was in June of this year. It was a disturbing the peace call, and I'm not quite sure what the specifics were on that. Perhaps the applicant as well could explain a little further. The garages on the property are not conforming. This rear detached unit has two single car garages below the upstairs unit, but it does appear to have adequate off-street parking. In addition to the two single car garages, there is this property, and I'll pull it up in just a moment on the screen. Is an odd-shaped property. The rear of the property is approximately 65 feet wide. It's kind of a pie-shaped lot. The property, in addition to the two single-car garages, does have an inset area to park three cars, or up to three cars, off the street, as well as a fourth car perpendicular to the alley. And I believe the imagery I'll be showing momentarily does actually show what appears to be a Chevy Blazer, which is a decent-sized automobile parked in that parallel spot and completely out of the alley. So while the parking itself is not conforming due to garage space, there does appear to be an adequate amount of off-street parking. Staff has received one email in opposition to this project as well as one email in support. I believe one of the emails was included with the staff report since staff received it prior to the staff reports being distributed, and the second one was placed on the dais before you this evening since it was just received today. With that concludes staff's report. We are recommending approval with conditions, and I'm available for any questions.
Thank you. Are there any questions of staff?
I had a question regarding the parking. On the site plan map that we received, it appears that there's three, driveway parking spaces or three off-street parking spaces independent of the garage. Is that accurate, Jerry?
That is, and I'll be able to show it to you in just one moment here.
And are those, I was looking for the conditional use permit requirement that required the parking, and I couldn't find it in here. Could you tell me which number it is?
1 second.
Oh, item number 11.
That is, yes, correct. Condition number 11.
So we're requiring the at least one garage space to be free and clear as one additional off-street space in order for two occupants to be allowed in the vacation rental?
As the resolution is written, yes. We are requiring at least one garage space and one additional off-street parking space. But in my subsequent discussions with the property owner, he did wish to amend that, and I think even if it were the case that, say, you had a husband and wife and they're, you know, one or two children, it's reasonable to assume they would all be arriving in the same car. Staff's intent with the two required spaces would be the occupants would use one space, and if they had visitors, there would still be an off-street space available for visitors or family or whoever it may be. We don't feel that having more than two adults in the unit would be appropriate, because then you're running into a situation where, you know, it's likely that you would have more than one car. But again, I'll let the applicant elaborate further, and then it would be up to the commission as to whether they feel that is appropriate. But if you look at the screen right now, this is the rear of the property. This is the unit in question above the two single-car garages, which you can get a little better view here. These are the two single-car garages associated with the property. There is also, as you see off to the right here, a vehicle parked right along the alley line. Let me see if I can. Now, this is kind of a tight fit. It does appear that it is kind of just right on the line here. Again, it's an SUV. It's a little larger vehicle. Obviously, a compact car would fit a lot cleaner into that spot, but it does appear that this is out of the alley. But additionally, you have spaces off here to the right, which in one of the photographs I saw, and that's kind of the beauty of Google Maps, is that a lot of their imagery, even of the same property, is taken at different times. There was an image, I think it was the direct overhead one, where there were cars actually, yeah, you can see here, where there is a car, and it does appear to be inside and this looks like more like a full-size sedan that is inside the line, and you know, it does appear that three cars could be parked in this area. So again, you have the potential to park five cars off the street on this property.
Six, wouldn't it be?
Six.
I'm sorry, six, yes. Yeah. If you count the two garage spaces, the parallel space, and then these three spaces.
Thank you, Jerry. Any other questions? Ms. Cummings? No. Dr. Goldberg?
Well, I had a similar question regarding the application date, which is on July 9th, versus the deadline of the 6th. Jerry, could you review with us what the circumstances here were, why you waived the deadline on this case?
Yes, this was another application that was received on July 9th, which was the Monday following the July 6th deadline. Again, I was out of the office on vacation from July 1st to July 7th, and I had, again, been in contact with this property owner prior to my going on vacation. It's my understanding that he did come in the week I was out to submit and wanted to ensure that I was the one that accepted the application to review it for completeness. So he returned on Monday when I was back in the office, and that's when the application was submitted.
Thank you.
Okay. We'll open the public hearing. Would the applicant like to come up and speak? Tell us about your project.
Good evening. My name is Don Marr. This is my lovely wife, Carol Marr. And just to give you a little bit of background, we lived on Fifth Street for about 2 years. Then we moved to the up on the hill. We lived in South Shore Drive for about 3 years. And we've been down on this property for 23 years. She actually lived in the property on Fifth Street 2 years prior to that. So we've been around a while. We're familiar with the town. As we began this particular process, we were kind of naive to what we were going to do, but Kyle and Elena next door were kind of our shining light to this is how you can do it. So we followed them to a T in terms of our contract. We actually took their contract and formulated it to fit exactly like theirs. because we, you know, we were kind of new to this. And along the process, we have paid our dues like we're supposed to. The numbers are, since 2008, when we started sending in the bed tax, we've brought into the city about $6,400, and we paid our business license each since 2010 for another $600. So we brought in about $7,000 into the community. But more importantly, we brought in a lot of really nice people that spent a lot of money here. And so we want you to just be aware that it's a good moneymaker for the city. I mean, it's been pretty good. Now, the essence of who we're primarily giving this rental opportunity to is to families. The majority of the people that come in from Arizona, they come in from Canada, and they do come back often, many times. But it's usually a family. And usually that indicates that there's going to be one car. But as you can see, we have created an opportunity for other cars in case they do happen to have two cars, which does happen on a rare occasion, but it does happen occasionally. So we got plenty of parking there. We never put them behind the garage, even though some people have to do that on COA. We don't do that because if we put them behind the garage, then we would have a problem because we wouldn't be able to get out of our garage. So they park in the parallel one, and then they park, if they have one extra car, on those three other choices there. So that's the parking that we provide. The only situation that we'd like to discuss the possibility of the only two, because a lot of people come with kids, and we have a really nice pull-out sofa and a nice big room dedicated. Most of the apartment above the garage is dedicated to a living room. There's a little nook for eating, a nice kitchen, a bathroom, and a one-bedroom, pretty good-sized bedroom. But the actual living room place is more than twice as big as the bedroom. So it makes it we actually sent Jerry a link to the VRBO if you guys want to see what it looks like. We have some pictures of it, and I don't know if that would help you in your decision on that, but we would love to have it to be four because so many families come in with, you know, a couple kids.
Yeah, or five. The living room itself is almost 300 square feet, so it's very large, the living room. And for example, I jotted down the people that have rented just for the last 8 months, I guess, just to give you an idea of our renters, the demographics. The people that are there now are a young couple with a two-year-old, and they are actually residents. They live on the hill. They're having their home remodeled, so they are renting from us. They are one of the few people that have actually had two cars, because vacationers, as a rule, only have one car. I know I would never rent two or three cars with even a large family. The two people prior to that were two middle-aged men that stayed there for a month. Before that, there was an elderly couple and they that were there for 2 weeks, and they're coming back next July for a month and a half. They have one car. Before that, it was a couple with three kids from ages 6 to 14. And they're coming back at Christmas for a week, and that's the fifth time they've been there. Never had any problems. Before that, it was a young couple with a child. Before that, it was a couple with three kids, young kids. Before that, it was one adult. Now, we've been doing monthly rentals for 20 years prior to doing the vacation rentals, and I have to say that I've had no problems with the vacation rentals, probably more with some of the monthly rentals. You know, people are here because they're happy and want to have fun, and they're not causing problems. I'm really sorry about the woman's having problems with break-ins, but I can't see that any of my the type of people that I'm renting to would have anything to do with that. So,
well, the other thing is I wanted you guys to be aware of is in 2009, I was laid off from a job that I'd had for 37 years. So I am on there 24/7. And this is my baby. I'm taking care of it. And there's about 30 feet between my back door and their window. So if there's anything going on, I'm the one that's aware of it. Now, about the police report, I'm sad to say that was my 23-year-old celebrating his birthday. And that was in the jacuzzi down below.
He was in the jacuzzi.
He was in the jacuzzi with some of his friends. And so some neighbor called, and they came in and said, you guys got to go in the house. You're making too much noise.
I said, okay.
And that's pretty much what that was all about. So I apologize for that, but it didn't have anything to do with the rental at all. It had to do with a 23-year-old having a party in our jacuzzi. So, you know, that's the story of that. I have a record of every client we've ever had since 2008. She's going to read to you some of the specifications that they sign on when they sign up with us. They have to pay a security deposit. It is a chunk of money. This helps to determine what's going to be going down because they're going to lose it if they don't abide by these rules. And this is straight off of Kyle and Elena's contract.
Right. That we have been using, and it's pretty common. Obviously, that is a security and damage deposit that they're leaving, but also the important points that's marked important points is that we mutually agree to the following: anyone beyond the above mentioned guests who is sleeping overnight needs to be cleared with the owners and may incur additional charges. No dogs, cats, or other pets are allowed. No smoking is allowed in the house or no less than 10 feet away. No excessive noise disturbances at any time, day or night. Any noise complaints from neighbors and or visits from the police will be grounds for eviction and or loss of security deposit. No parties of any kind are allowed. And the rest of it is just, you know, stuff relating to the apartment. But we're pretty strong in our the way that we run our place and the way that we screen our applicants. And we've made some really close friends, actually.
We've met
wonderful people.
A lot of people coming back for 3 and 4 years from many places, Arizona, Canada. We made some good friends. And most of the people we get from VRBO are really nice. And the money seems to separate the wheat from the chaff because they have to come up with the bucks. And then we're right there, and we talk to them, and then there's something posted in the unit itself that says, you're in a neighborhood. Take it easy on this, because if you make a lot of noise, you're going to hear about it.
And it seems to me it's actually to the city's advantage to have vacationers that are, you know, nice vacationers that are spending money downtown. I mean, our monthly rentals didn't walk downtown every day and buy food and buy knickknacks and T-shirts and all that stuff from the sale. So we're actually, you know, bringing some revenue in as well.
So. Okay, thank you for your comments. Are there any questions from the commission?
Could you tell us how it's how you currently handle your parking? Do you typically use one car or one garage space for your
tenants? No, my husband
tenants?
And I park in the garage.
We both use the garage. Right. The outside is dedicated for them. We do not have an in garage space dedicated for them. I didn't know that was a problem. I hadn't heard that was a problem before.
So
it's never been a complaint from anybody.
Yeah, I don't think.
So because on one of the conditions of approval, item number 11, at least one garage space and one off-street parking space adjacent to the rear alley shall remain free and clear of any and all obstructions that may preclude occupants and their daytime guests from utilizing the garage and parking space for parking vehicles. So I took that to mean that the conditional use permit is requiring that one of those garage spaces is for the tenants inside the rental, not for the main house.
Why would that be?
Well, that's what I was asking the question for.
I guess I didn't read it carefully, but I didn't.
We hadn't heard that. We didn't know that was an issue.
People on vacation don't generally need a garage. I mean, we have adequate parking as is.
Commissioner Everson, if I may, I believe staff's intent with that was to, as we heard from a previous speaker, if someone wished to park in a garage rather than leave their car outside or on the street, that we were imposing that condition to have a garage available if a tenant so chose to do that. Now, they may not all want to do that. They might, if they're going to be coming and going throughout the day, it might be easier just to park in one of the uncovered non-garage spaces, but staff's intent was to make a garage space available if a tenant so chose to park there. Now, that's something that if you feel you might want to modify, then that would be up to the discretion.
So my statement was incorrect then to the applicant about my assumption was that one space was to be designated for the unit itself, but that was not necessarily what was in the staff report.
No, the way the condition is written is that one garage space as well as one non-garage space be made available for the rental unit.
I think that with the plethora, if I may use that word, of parking spaces at this particular property, the garage space is probably okay to leave off.
No, perhaps. I was unclear about the requirement and how it was used. That's why I brought up the question while the applicant was up here.
It's never been asked once, not since 2008.
Okay. Any other questions, Dr. Goldberg?
I have some comments, but not questions for the applicant, I don't think.
Ms. Cummings? No. Then go ahead. And do we need the applicant up here for you to make your comments?
No.
You may be seated. We may call you back up. Thank you.
Regarding
Dr. Goldberg, just a moment.
Yeah, just since this is a public hearing, it'd be appropriate to allow other people to speak,
yes.
And then you can deliver your comments.
Sorry.
And anyone else like to speak on this case?
Mike Beebe, Seal Beach. About the parking again, this location has plenty of off-street parking, and it also happens to be in a place where it's very near the beach, where a lot of people park on the street and go to the beach. I have no problem with leaving the garage out of the CUP, but I would like the commission to consider once again requiring that the renters use the parking places that are off. That are off the alley, that they required them that they use the off-street parking. And to kind of jump ahead perhaps to 5 years in the future when we have electronic, you know, devices that can monitor and locate cars, I can see the day when, and this is not Orwellian or draconian or invasive and government, you know, telling us what to do, but I can see the point in time where, you know, an electronic marker would be on a car, and we could identify if a car was a rental car and parked on the street or not. But let's throw that aside. I see eyes rolling and, crazy Mike is up here talking. There's plenty of off-street parking. And as far as enforcement of off-street parking, we're talking about enforcing the number of people that are there, party noise, other things like that that are not exactly easy to do. And if we don't ask for the off-street parking to be used, then we're inviting people to park, you know, on the street. So I see nothing wrong with requiring the renters to use off-street parking. And as far as having two adults and three children, I see nothing wrong with that too. But I really would like to see the parking requirement, the CUP require that all the cars park off the street.
Thank you. Anyone else? Okay. Commission, all right. One more.
Can you go to the one picture that shows other places around? Okay. I own the property, not directly behind that, but the other way. Over there, the duplex right there.
Next door?
No. The apartment that they're talking about is there.
Right.
Not the one behind it, but the one right there.
Okay.
That's my property, and then I live down the street. And it just seems like all of a sudden everybody is going to have vacation rentals in our area. We have the one that has that used to be an illegal unit is over two doors over, and that has only one parking place, and there's three cars. And then you're putting some on 1605, you're allowing that without proper parking.
1605, we haven't seen yet, have we?
I mean, it's just ridiculous.
1605 Seal Way or 1605 Ocean?
Seal Way.
The commission has not seen that application
yet.
No,
we haven't seen that yet.
All right, that one, from what I understand, there is short parking on some of the others here. And it just seems very, very crowded. And I think it's wrong. My house has three parking places, three garages. We use two because we have two cars. And I think I told you before, my son parked in the apron behind our house, and the illegal one next door to me wrote vulgar letters, words, all over my son's car that was parked on our apron legally, and they said they were going to get him. We had to call the police out. The police couldn't do anything because we didn't have any proof that it was this person, but we knew it because he kept offering my son marijuana cigarettes to get him to leave. I mean, it's ridiculous. But anyway, it just seems like my little area of town is being really impacted by the vacation rentals, and it just doesn't seem fair.
Thank you. Anyone else? All right. Dr. Goldberg, would you like to make some comments?
A couple comments. Regarding condition 11, which has to do with the parking garage, I don't think we have an interest in forcing the short-term renters to use the garage in lieu of the homeowners. But we do have an interest, and there is a public interest, in conditioning that the homeowner keep both of those garage spaces open and available for parking cars. I mean, of course, that is the law in the city. But what I'd like to change this condition to say that both garage spaces shall remain free and clear of any obstructions that may interfere with parking. And then modify this to say that two off-street parking spaces, you know, should also be kept clear of obstructions. Because remember, this conditional use permit that you're granting is going to go with the property. And so, you know, the applicants that are before us, they're good citizens, and they keep their garage free and clear, and they're parking both of their cars. And so as we look at this application today, it seems like it's overparked. But there's nothing to prevent them from selling the property, and the next owners could use those two garage spaces for storage, or at least one of the garage spaces for storage. So I would like to see this change so that both garage spaces must be kept free and clear, but we could word it such that
for as long as the vacation rental is in existence,
right, for the conditional use permit. But then I would not as part of that, I wouldn't force the renters to use the garage. I think the homeowners can use the garage. But our interest is that they're presenting a property with that has, you know, maybe five parking spaces, and that addresses a lot of the concerns that we heard from the public just now. And I'd like to keep it at five spaces, especially if we're going to increase the occupancy there. In regards to the increasing the occupancy, the applicant would like us. What I heard the applicant say is they'd like for us to allow up to three children. And again, for the public's benefit, we've had this conversation before about children versus adults. And I've always felt it was okay to specify children, and so I would be okay with two adults and up to three children.
Minor children?
I would say up to the age of 18. I know we have to define it.
Yeah, minor children then.
I would say up to the age of 18, I would say. And I'm okay with that. Again, if we're having them maintain five parking spaces, that's fine. We haven't differentiated between adults and children before, but again, I really wasn't clear on why we couldn't do that either. I don't know if our substitute attorney can chime in on that.
Craig and I talked about that, and I understand the prior concern, but this is a condition that I think is appropriate in this case, and it sounds like the applicant will comply with that. And so it's worth putting it into the resolution.
Okay.
It doesn't
seem to be in
here now. So those are two changes that I would suggest.
And again, I'm sympathetic with Mr. Beebe's concerns about where they park and prohibiting parking and all that. And I support those concerns, but just sounds like staff is not recommending that we do that because of practical considerations with today's technology, at least. So those are my comments. I would approve with two changes.
Okay, so it's condition 7, there shall be no more than a total of 2 overnight guests, two adult guests in the vacation rental with up to 3 minor children.
No more than 2 adults and plus three children. No older than 18, or you could say under the age of 19.
Three minor children. 18 is the age of majority, so they'd be under the age of 18.
Whatever you all feel is appropriate.
Because if the age of minority changes, then it just goes with it.
I was just thinking a high school senior could be 18 and still living with the parents and traveling with the parents. So I'm okay with 18.
And then condition 10?
Condition 11? Condition 7.
That was 7.
And then the garage is 11.
So actually, way you could rewrite 11 is just at least 2 garage spaces.
I think that's all you need to change.
Two garage spaces.
Plus 2 additional.
Plus 2 additional off-street parking shall remain free and clear of any obstructions that may preclude. And you could just say occupants or residents and their daytime guests.
Commissioner Goldberg, if I might, I think the way I understood you wanting to reword that was that as long as the CUP is valid, that both existing garages would remain free and clear for parking, and that at least 2 off-street spaces would remain available for any occupants of the short-term rental.
Right. You said it better than I did.
Perfect, Jerry.
I write these conditions.
Those are my 2 recommendations.
And so if that's a motion and there's a second.
It's not a motion yet.
Not yet? Okay.
Would it be appropriate to allow the applicant to comment on the changes?
I was going to ask if there were any other comments. And would the applicant like to comment on our comments and changes to the conditions? One of you. Just your name.
Okay, my name is Don Marr. I just want to make sure I understand it. If we're going to enforce this, I want to understand it. So you're saying that the garage has to be made available to either a resident or a tenant?
No.
No.
We're saying that your 2-car garage must be free and clear at all time and available for parking. Oh. That means you can't use a garage for storage.
Got it. No problem. We have 2 cars. They have to get in there. So they're there. They're in there all the time. They've been there since we...
Okay. And then we changed condition 7 to allow minor children as well.
Perfect. Thank you very much for that. I appreciate that.
Do you have an opinion regarding whether that age limit on the children should be 17 or 18?
Well, the only problem we might have is we have people that have, like this one family, they have a 17-and-a-half-year-old and another one, and they've been coming back for every year after year after year. So at some point, we're going to have to say, sorry, George can't come with the family. I guess that's what happens.
They'll have to find a bigger unit.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true. That can do. They can do that.
What is the bed configuration in the bedroom?
Oh, the bedroom has a nice queen-size bed. It's too bad you can't pull up those pictures, Jerry. You can kind of see it. We spent a lot of money on this thing, converting it to vacation rental, and I sent him a link that shows the pictures. Hopefully he can dig it up.
Just a queen-size bed in there?
It's a queen-size bed in the one bedroom. In the living room, which is, like she said, is almost 300 square feet, it has a pull-out sofa, brand new. And then on the other side of the living room in the corner is a day bed, which you can use as a couch, or you can use it as for a small person.
So you have room for 5 people to easily be 5, in a bed.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, and we've been doing that for a long time, and it hasn't been a problem because we didn't know it was a problem. And I brought in 7 different lists of all the people that have gone on VRBO and said, we love the place, we slept 5 people here, no problems. And I can give those to every one of you guys if you want to see them. They are lists of what they said was perfect. We have 35 five-star reviews on VRBO, and of those, I grabbed about seven of them, printed seven copies, and it's all of people saying, we had a family here, plenty of room, great time, we want to come back. And if you want to read those, I'd be happy to give them to you, because I made copies for you.
Thank you. Any other comments on what we changed?
No, that's fine. I'm happy.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We'll close the public hearing now. And what is the pleasure of the commission?
I'd move that we approve the conditional use permit with the amendments to items number 7 and number 11 suggested by Dr. Goldberg.
I second that motion.
Discussion?
Discussion?
Would it be age 18 or 17? I would like age 18.
18 is majority, right?
18 is okay. 19 is not okay.
Change the minor to age 18.
Right.
Okay.
So you're including 18, so no.
18 is okay.
18.
Okay, so it's anyone under 19, any kid under 19.
All right, please vote. Okay, 4-0.
Once again, the decision of the Planning Commission may be appealed by any interested party by filing an appeal with the city clerk within 10 days of tonight's decision starting tomorrow. Tomorrow is the first day.
Okay. Next item on the agenda is conditional use permit 12-16 at 246 17th Street.
Madam Chair, I'd like
yes.
to notify the commission. I need to recuse myself from participating in this public hearing as my property is located within 500 feet of the subject property.
Thank you. And you can wait outside. Okay, can we have a staff report, please?
Yes, Madam Chair, members of the commission, this item is conditional use permit 12-16 at 246 17th Street. The request is for a conditional use permit to allow an approximately 633 square foot room addition, a 93 square foot garage addition, and an approximately 210 square foot roof deck addition to an existing non-conforming single family dwelling within the residential high density zone. The property is presently non-conforming due to substandard garage space and substandard garage setbacks. On this particular item, there is a detached garage at the rear of the single-family dwelling, and this particular garage is a large one-car garage that has a substandard side yard and substandard rear yard setback. The project, as submitted, staff's opinion was that it complied with the provisions of Section 11.4.40.020. Which allows conditional use permits for structural alterations and additions to single-family dwellings. In this case, the exception being the garage setbacks. Staff was informed by the city attorney's office that the way that code section is written, that the non-conforming side yard setback, which is presently 1 foot, would actually, if it were to remain, it actually would not comply with this code section. So what staff is recommending, in addition to the conditions that have been placed on the project, that an additional condition be added, and a revised resolution has been placed before you on the dais this evening that also requires not only the interior garage space to be expanded to accommodate two cars inside the garage, but also that 1 foot non-conforming setback be brought into conformance, which in this case would be a minimum 3 foot setback. And that was, as I mentioned, that was inadvertently overlooked by staff in the staff report, and I do apologize. But the city attorney did happen to bring that to my attention, and it has been corrected. The revised resolution, as I mentioned, is also before you. Everything else in as proposed in the plans that were submitted do appear to comply with this code section. And with that, staff does not see any potential adverse issues with allowing this modest expansion of what's currently a relatively small house We think the expansion is a relatively, even though they are technically almost doubling the size of the house, even with this addition, you're going to end up with a roughly 1,300 square foot house, which is a fairly modest house considering some of the houses that have recently been built in Old Town. And with that, staff is recommending approval with the conditions as revised. And this concludes my staff report. I'm available for any questions.
Thank you. Are there any questions of staff? Dr. Goldberg?
So right now the garage setback is 1 foot, and you're going to require them to move the side of the garage in 2 feet?
Well, originally what was being proposed, the garage has a side yard setback on the north side of the garage of approximately 1 foot, and I believe the rear setback is 8 feet, where under today's code a 12-foot setback would be required. The applicant's original proposal was to the garage is kind of pushed to one side of the property. There's a much larger setback on the south side, and their original proposal was to expand the garage out on the south side where they have additional room to work with to get a conforming interior garage space.
Right.
What staff was unaware of when the staff report was written was that the way that code section that allows the conditional use permit for the expansion is written is that it wouldn't allow that 1 foot setback to remain. So essentially they would either need to pull the north side of the garage in and accordingly push the south side out. So what you would likely end up with on a 25-foot wide lot is the 3 foot setback on either side of the garage to give you that garage width of 18 feet. So how that's accomplished, that's not really staff's place to tell the applicant or their designer how to accomplish that. The only thing that we are looking for is that whatever that garage ends up to be, that it conform with the code. And in this case, it would need to be a minimum 3 foot side yard setback on either side.
Big change. This is a detached garage?
Correct. Okay. The original building permits, staff did not find original permits on file. Looking at the type and method of construction of the property, it looks like it was likely built sometime in the 1930s or 1940s. I did happen to find some aerial photography from 1952, and this house is in existence in 1952. So we know it was at least prior to 1952 it was constructed. But looking at it closer, it looks like it was probably a 1930s or 1940s construction.
Thank you.
Ms. Cummings. A question. If they tore the garage down and created open parking areas we saw in the last property we were looking at, would that be conforming? Kept area for two cars to park?
It would not be conforming to today's code if they did not rebuild a two-car garage. Today's code does require for residential uses a minimum two-car enclosed garage for off-street parking. Prior to the Title 11 zoning code that was enacted in January of 2011, we still did allow carports. So and we found that a lot of people didn't choose that route, but there are still a few carports around Old Town that are remnants from the Chapter 28 zoning code. But as of January 2011, a minimum two-car enclosed garage is the minimum requirement for off-street parking in residential properties.
So that means three walls and doors?
Correct.
Enclosed.
Three walls and a garage door.
Yeah.
Okay.
What would be the impact if they did nothing to this garage? Well, how would it change your recommendation?
The commission wouldn't be able to grant a conditional use permit if the proposal was to not change the garage. As the garage exists today, it's non-conforming with regard to both setbacks and interior space. So at a minimum, they would need to expand the garage to have an interior space that is conforming. That would allow them to apply for the CUP, or that would allow the commission to grant the CUP for the square footage expansion. But one of the stipulations of the code section 11.4.40.020 is that the minimum 3 foot side yard be maintained. So not only would they need to expand the interior space, they would also need to bring those setbacks into conformance. at least the side yard setbacks. The rear yard setback could, if the commission chose, could allow it to remain as non-conforming, provided the side yards were conforming and the garage space was brought to conform to today's code and the CUP were granted.
Are there any other questions of staff? Seeing none, then would the applicant like to come up? We'll open the public hearing.
Craig Garza, Seal Beach.
Tori Jones, I'm the building designer and Greg is the owner of the property. Originally, how you see the plans, when we went to apply for the CUP, we were not notified that we had to bring that 3-foot setback in, which really does change a lot of the process. We were notified yesterday at about 3 o'clock that this was happening. So we're kind of at a point where do we move forward? The garage, I've worked in Seal Beach for a long time. I actually grew up in town. And most of the projects that we've done, if we hadn't touched the structure and it was non-conforming, if the rest, what we were touching was conforming, we didn't have to change that. Mm-hmm. I know since the code changed last year, now we're required to do a lot more, which obviously financially puts a burden on
but it makes the project nicer.
Right. That's true. And we knew that we needed to make the garage a two-car garage from the get-go. So that's what we, you know, initially proposed, which would have just extended the structure. And not, if we have to bring the 3-foot setback in, then basically we're taking maybe a $10,000 job to probably a $40,000 job. And I know that, you know, that's not necessarily your concern, but my clients recently moved here. His wife grew up in Los Alamitos at the Navy base, and she loves it, and they did everything they could just to get back here. They live in a 694-square-foot house now. So just to modestly increase the size, all of the addition is coming off of the back of the house, so the front of the house still stays bungalow feel. Doing the garage, and now what we find from yesterday that we have to do, really impacts actually this whole project. And I'll let my client speak further on that.
I just want to say, first and foremost, I'm so proud and blessed to get to be in this community, and I consider myself, lucky to be here. So is my wife. One thing Tori didn't mention is we also have a 4-year-old son who she knows is, a handful. And, you know, we're just trying to make this whole thing work. You know, we met when we were 16, just down the road. It's our favorite place to go. We talked about retiring to Old Town one day if we ever got lucky enough. And circumstances, what they were, that was able to happen recently in the last few months. To say that, this is a modest addition is exactly that. I'm a man that doesn't have, extraordinary means. We've exhausted, most of our resources to have the plans drawn up to where they were 48 hours ago. I've met with our contractor today, and this is going to increase our cost by at least 15 to 20%, which I can't afford. I know that's not the concern of the commission, but I would like to point it out. With that said, I want to also point out that while we weren't informed about this, I don't see this as the, Jerry was very accommodating during the whole process over the last couple of months, getting us up to this point. And I didn't see, I want to make sure that we're not throwing anyone under the bus. And I definitely understand council's position also with this recommendation from yesterday. I do want to point out one thing on this project. This is costing us, you know, while it's going to be a couple hundred thousand dollars, I made it a point to work with local people, folks that are in Old Town, contractors that are in Old Town, so the dollars would come back here. I understand that, you know, the risk that you run when considering this is precedence and setting some type of precedence here. You know, I try to operate within all the guidelines, you know, working through all the systems that the city has set up. And based on where we were a couple of months ago, I would certainly appreciate if you'd consider those original that original request to make it a two-car garage, and you know, get more cars off the street. Definitely share these folks' concerns. Also, if you've ever been on 17th Street, we have the partiers over there across the street from my place with a lot of the vacationers. But with that said, I appreciate any consideration that you'd give to that original proposal as it was first submitted.
One other thing, if I could say, if you look at this image, that's the alley between 17th and Silbeach Boulevard. There's five or six homes, other than the one down at the bottom. They're all very modest. They all have one-car garages. All of them have the one-foot setback. Three out of the five of them have already been modified, so, you know, prior, obviously, to last year, which now, you know, we have to conform, obviously, with the new codes. But if you just look at what's there and what has been done, we're really not asking for more than what the three others that have been modified have done. And I can understand if, you know, we were actually touching the garage, but we weren't, you know, the plan was to be able to keep the backyard space so that Gideon has a place to play. He's not on the street. He's not across the street from, I think there's three or four short-term vacation rentals. Every time I go to meet with them, you know, there's five or six or eight people out there and all of their towels, and, you know, it just looks short-term. So just based on the context of the area, to be able to keep that 1 foot setback would be pretty important.
Thank you.
Oh, lastly, I'd be happy to pay any, you know, be indemnified and then pay any costs that come after the fact.
Okay,
you guys would consider this. Thank you very much.
Question for the applicant.
Okay. Oh, we have a question for you.
I just want to know, what is your house? Is it? Is this? Which one is yours?
No, it's the brown one.
This right there.
The umbrella.
Yes.
Okay. So your point that you were trying to make is that these two are also probably very close, or 1 foot.
All five of them.
All four of them.
If you look at
up.
Right. This is your neighbor right here.
Both have 1 foot, and
right.
That one's still a one-car garage.
But your immediate neighbor's 1 foot, and you're 1 foot, and so your roofs are almost touching. Or
yeah.
The eaves are inches apart, looks like to me.
It's a fire code now.
And then you're saying that you have the same setup here, right?
Correct.
And then are you saying this one is?
That's still a one-car garage. It's not obviously next to.
Okay. Is the setback here 1 foot from the?
No. It's just showing it as a one-car garage.
Yeah. No, actually, I'm not sure.
Doesn't look like it's sitting against anything.
It would be that one right there. Yeah. No, actually, it does look like it. Because
looks like it may. It
like
may
six
be.
Feet in between.
It looks like that's, on this side there might be a.
Yeah, yeah, that's a non-conforming.
So it's right on.
It's non-conforming to today's code, but at one time it was allowed.
Until last year.
So your point is that there's
four or five, well, not counting yours, three or four other ones. And then you were saying that several other neighbors have redone projects like yours? Is that,
yeah,
is that what you were trying to say?
The one right next door.
This one here?
And then the one, not the blue one, but the one.
This one here.
And that's kind of where we're going, not that look, obviously. Mm-hmm. But as far as size, we're actually a little bit smaller than that. In scale.
When were those projects done? You may have said, I'm sorry.
I don't know
an exact date, but I believe that up until approximately 2004, that there was a provision in the code that allowed an expansion without having to bring a garage into conformance. And then around 2004, the code was changed to allow no expansions to any non-conforming properties unless that property was brought into total conformance.
It was before Title 11. It was
correct.
Before our big Title 11.
Correct. It was actually while we were still under Chapter 28, but even several years before Title 11. And then due to some feedback from property owners that with single-family dwellings that wanted to make modest additions and had no way to – there were no process to go through to allow modest additions with the Title 11 zoning code, it was changed again to allow, through the conditional use permit process, additions to single-family dwelling properties, provided that the only non-conformities were either garage setbacks or building height.
Not both. You can't have two.
Well, you could have a non-conforming property that had both a non-conforming garage setback and non-conforming height. But it didn't allow things like non-conforming garage areas or multi-unit properties were not able to go through the conditional use permit process. So it was a very, very limited.
Could they go through the variance process instead?
They could. That would be an option. I don't know just offhand. I mean, I don't know what more of the specifics of the property, but just looking at the property itself, there doesn't appear to be any physical constraint that would preclude them from bringing the property into the conformance.
Thank you. Thank you.
Anyone else like to comment from the audience?
I'm sorry, Barbara Barton, Old Town. You know, I guess maybe I ought to apply for a CUP for my property. Is it too late, Jerry?
Your property would not be able to since it is a multi-unit property.
Get out of here. Thank you.
Okay. Can we have some discussion?
Can Quinn give us any options that we might have in this situation that would somehow relieve these people from having to spend this extra $30,000 or $40,000?
Well, the one possibility that Jerry mentioned, which could not be accomplished tonight, would be go through the variance process, and they would have to come back, and you'd have to notice the public hearing on the variance request. And once again, you know, Jerry, I'm sure you've heard this from Jerry many, many times, but there has to be some unusual circumstances that deprives this particular property from privileges enjoyed by other properties in the neighborhood. And it's quite possible that the second prong, based on looking at these garages, could be satisfied, but it's not necessarily that. It, you know, probably it's the same size as all the other lots. It's probably the 25 by 80, maybe?
It's 100 in this case.
100? Okay. That was my original guess, but. Yeah, so, but, you know, it's something you can consider. I mean, you can't grant the variance tonight, but you could, the applicant could always apply for a variance, and we'll come back at a future date, and see if those findings can be made. That's really the only option, because you don't have the power right now to grant the variance, so, and you can't grant the CUP since it doesn't comply with the code without that particular condition. Another option is to grant the CUP subject to granting a variance, and that's not as clean as just having them come back.
The only way we could grant the CUP is if we included a requirement that the garage be relocated completely and be in conformance.
Yes, that's the new condition.
Okay.
And the revised resolution.
It does have
it's under a, two. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Goldberg, any comments?
No, it's. I think our hands are tied. That's what the city attorney's telling us, and even the variance. Obviously, they can pursue a variance, but it sounds like like it's not much hope for that. I mean, they can discuss that with staff further, what the probability there is. So, it's just unfortunate that they got misinformation from staff. And, you know, they just found out today. Sometimes that happens. We've seen that before, and you know, we have very good staff. But sometimes it just takes a fresh set of eyes on things. And you know, we apologize for that inconvenience and that extra cost. But that does happen from time to time, and I think our hands are tied. So I'm
afraid I'd have to agree. I'm not sure that making an application for a variance would be in your best interest, because it costs money and it's non-refundable, and if you lose, you lose. You're back to square one. So,
do we have the authority to waive the variance application
no.
fee?
Oh no.
Well, no. The city council could waive the fee, but not the commission.
Would anyone like to? Let me make the motion. I would like to make the motion.
Since we're shorthanded, yeah. That's okay.
I would like to adopt the recommendation to approve conditional use permit 1216, and including the revised condition that indicates the garage shall be relocated. It would be condition 16, accepting the garage's side yard setback. The garage must maintain a minimum 3-foot side yard setback on both sides. And
I'm sure that's condition two.
Is a condition? It's condition two, but it's okay.
Referring to
conditional
permit 16.
Use permit 1216. Okay, I'm sorry. And I with that condition change on number two, that we adopt the recommendation for approval for conditional use permit 1216. Is there a second?
Madam Chair, just a comment. There are other changes in here. They added the section C here. There's a reference section 5.
Section C.
New language too.
I believe some of the additional language was just findings to conform to the revised conditions.
Yeah, that's right. It's a finding. It's a finding, not a condition. Okay. Let's do this. I make a motion to approve 12-27 with the modification of finding C and the modification of condition number two. Is there a second?
Yes, I'll second that.
Please vote. Whoop, there you go. Yeah,
I hesitated because the applicant wanted it.
3-0. Is there something you would like to say now?
Greg Garza, Seal Beach. Would I be able to request this be done in, to give me maybe 24 months to comply with the conforming garage with the CUP?
The conditional use permit's good for 12 months?
They would need to
ask for
act
an extension.
Upon the conditional use permit within 12 months, meaning once a building permit is issued, that so they would need to actually
be issued a building permit within 12 months. Once that permit is issued, you have up to 180 days get an inspection on that permit. So there are technically ways to
right, and you can always ask for an extension.
Okay.
Okay, so there are ways your designer can help you get through that part of it. Okay.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Chair, anyone can appeal this decision by filing an appeal with the city clerk within 10 days of tomorrow.
Thank you. Okay, can we have the director's report? Wait. Oh, Commissioner. I forgot about him already.
I thought he'd gone home.
And the record should reflect that he did recuse himself and stated the reason why on the record.
Yes. Okay, we'll have the director's report now.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. The only thing I was going to mention was that for the agenda forecast for October 3rd, as a result of the City Council asking the Planning Commission to look at a vacation rental ordinance, which would restrict future vacation rental units, we have actually scheduled a public hearing for October 3rd. And because of that, because we have several other items on the agenda that night, we're asking that what would have been the continued hearing for the rooftop deck ordinance, that be postponed until October 17th. And we would be re-advertising that, republishing that in the newspaper so folks would know about that. That way you would have plenty of time to look at both those ordinances so they're not on the same agenda. And that concludes my report.
Looks like the third will be there'll be four cases plus the moratorium.
Correct.
Okay. Is there any way we could cut that down a bit? I mean, that's going
to
be a
it's always subject to change.
I believe we have those, Jerry, don't we already have those advertised?
One of them I got in the mail today.
Actually, yeah. Yes, those have all been noticed.
And so. Because council was they asked that the commission move forward quickly on the ordinance pertaining to the vacation rentals, we have advertised that for that evening as well. So all of these items have been advertised for that date.
Okay.
We get overtime?
Certainly.
Yes, we do get overtime. Double time.
Right. This is making up for the first half of the year having several canceled right. meetings due to lack of agenda.
Right. Yeah. We don't get. Well,
anyway. Are there any commission concerns?
Nothing from me.
The tattoo parlor permanent sign has been installed.
Yes, it has.
Almost like the banner better. But you'll have to take a look and see.
I have not seen the installed sign. I have only seen drawings of the, okay. the drawings looked acceptable to me. Now you're telling me that I might be surprised to see the permanent signage.
Yes, the banner is down.
Okay, I have nothing. Dr. Goldberg?
I'm still waiting to see brief staff report on the parking study at shops at Rossmore.
My apologies. We will try to, if we can get that on October 3rd, maybe.
No.
We can just do a receive and file, right?
Yeah,
you could. Yes. We could just include it in the pack, not actually have it as an agenda item, just to receive
and
file.
Can you just email that to us rather than paper?
There's a lot of public interest in that.
Oh, okay. The shops in Rossmore?
Yeah, there is.
Because of the lack of parking?
The whole issue of parking, and it's also a noise survey, right? Parking and noise.
I'm not sure what the specific. I knew there was a parking and circulation analysis, I believe. I don't know if noise, were there some?
Who would have done the parking and circulation analysis?
This was the city engineer, Public Works Department, I believe, was in charge of the traffic or parking analysis.
And the noise issue has to do with the deliveries in the alley, I assume?
I believe so. Again, I'm not
clear on the specifics of what studies occurred out there. I do know that a parking study did occur. I don't know if there was an additional noise study.
Yeah.
It was done by a contractor. It may have been coordinated by staff, but it was done by a contractor. They did budget about $80,000 for it. And I think about $6,000 of that was for a noise survey. And there is some public interest in it, at least. But receive and file is fine. And if it's, you know, we can always come back and ask questions later. But I'd like to get it into the public domain.
Okay. I'd like to see that, too. Mm-hmm. It is impacted a lot of the time. Okay. And no other commission concerns, then we'll adjourn to the meeting of October 3rd. Thank you all.